I'm Mahati Chamarthy. I work for Intel as a software engineer. So today I'm going to briefly talk about the status of client-side caching in Ceph. So I'll go over briefly of what Ceph is, what Rados block device is, and what's the current caching status on the RBD side it is. And we'll look at the write-back cache implementation that we're working on. That is, one is based on the SSDs, and the other one is targeted for persistent memory. And in our case, we're working on, we're working on the Intel Optane DC persistent memory module. And finally, we'll look at some performance numbers that we've gathered based on the work so far we've done. So as you know, Ceph is a software-defined distributed storage. It delivers object, file, and block storage in a single unified system. It gathers data from various clients, such as Rados Gateway, which is compatible with S3 and Swift. And the RBD and CephFS or any custom implementations that's using Librados API. So there's no single point of failure. It's hardware agnostic. So it receives data and it stores as objects. And object is essentially stored as a file on a disk, which is handled by the object storage daemons in the backend. So block devices are essentially also a bunch of objects that are striped across the Rados cluster. And one of the most common use cases is they're used as disks in virtual machines. So the kernel module is usually used in, say, container environments or bare metal environments. But the user space library is more targeted towards QMU or OpenStack or CloudStack and such environments. So these images are thin provisioned, they're resizable, and there's no, because they are striped across the cluster, they do not have a single point of failure, and they offer multiple features like snapshotting, copy on write, exclusive locking, and mirroring support as well per pool or per image. And this is handled by RBD mirror daemon handles takes care of mirroring. And it uses journaling as a prerequisite to implement it. So today, RBD offers in-memory caching state caching implementations like write around, write through, and write back. So these are implemented in RAM. So the effectively the capacity is smaller and they're not persistent. So essentially, this is similar to what you might call as hard disk caching. So it waits for a flush request from an OS and to flush the data. So in write around and write back, the request is returned to the user immediately. In write through, it waits until the data sits on all the replicas in the Ceph cluster. And it employs, it uses least recently used algorithm to implement these. So by default, you have write through until a user sends a flush request so that it's compatible with older clients, which do not send a flush request. RBD also has a recent implementation, which is shared read-only parent image cache. So this, the main use case for this kind of cache is for RBD cloned images. So if, for instance, like a lot of images that are cloned from a similar parent initially only access like very common portions of the parent image, so it makes sense to have a copy of it locally stored. So this cache does that. So it caches a local copy of the parent cache, and it enables the cloned images to attempt a read from it, so that the read I/O speed is improved and it reduces the cluster traffic from client to the network cluster traffic. So this requires explicit enabling and in the Ceph config file, and this is handled by a special daemon called Ceph immutable object cache daemon. So this brings me to write back hash. So in order to have something that's persistent that has a larger capacity, we saw value in implementing a write back hash that'll work with SSDs and persistent memories. So instead of request going directly through to libRBD, the now request goes to the cache, and then to the libRBD and to the cluster. So the goal is to have faster IOs for the RPD workloads. So here is a general architecture, the high level architecture for replicated write log, which is for the persistent memory caching. So it's implemented within libRBD. And so the replicator and write log components work together to flush the data to the cache device. So on the cache device, we create a pool file. A file, by default, it's about 1 GB, and it's for every RBD image we create a pool file on the cache device. And the request goes, the data is created on the device, and then the flusher will flush it down to the layers below it for the other existing caches. And finally to the OSDs. So on the storage nodes, we have a replica daemon. So the replica daemon is horizontally scalable. So you can have as many as storage nodes you have. Of course, you need to have the persistent memory module as well on each of the storage nodes. So it establishes a connection with the client node. And once that connection is successful, initially, it registers the pool. So a pool file is also created on the replica storage nodes. And once it establishes a connection via RDMA to the client node, effectively it consumes zero CPU cycles. And then there is a passive flusher, which on the storage node. So whenever the active one goes down, this flusher takes it up and it flushes, it ensures that the data is flushed to the OSDs. So all of this is, earlier today in the day, we've had talks that mentioned about persistent memory, and I hope that actually gave you an idea of where this sits on the stack. So we have implemented the persistent memory cache using a set of libraries which are a part of a persistent memory development kit, which is an ever-growing collection of libraries and tools. It's validated and tuned on both Linux and Windows. So specifically, we use libpmem object for the replicated write log implementation. It does it helps you do atomic transactions, and for a lot of information about this. This and the other libraries can be found on pmem.io/pmdk. There's also a small tutorial that will help you on like emulate persistent memory using a portion of DRAM so that you can try and test out these libraries on that website. This is the data layout for persistent memory. So initially, what we it's byte addressable, and initially what we have is pool root. It has pointers to the first and the first valid entry and the first free entry. The head and tail pointers pointing to a block of log entries. So the block is a circular ring of entries, and that has pointers in turn has pointers to the data buffers. So the libpmem object allocates the data and ensures the space within the pool, and we append these entries once we receive a user request. We append these entries and we put them in a queue, and then, but before that, the data is persisted using the libpmem object, and then we push it onto the device. And then finally, we update the pool root. This is the data layout for the SSD implementation. It's block addressable. We have a file system. We also have a file system for the persistent memory. But here I think the singular difference in the data layout implementation is how the data sits. Here we send both the log entries and the data together in one shot. And here, but this is also a circular ring of entries. And initially we have a super block that will point to the first free and first valid entries. And we have a set of log entries which has pointers to where the, which is followed by the data, and it also has pointers to the data address. And so we follow an eviction policy, and we do not replace the data in the cache, because once the data is flushed to the OSDs, we start retiring the entries. And meanwhile, if we do get any reads, we make an attempt to read from the cache. Otherwise, we send them to the layers beneath it. But we do not replace, we don't get data from OSDs and replace them on the cache. This is a high-level request flow. So a write request comes down a libRVD from the user. So we, in replicated write log case, we reserve data buffer. We create an entry in RAM, and we persist the data initially, and then we schedule our log entries and append them, put them in a queue. We have a separate thread pool for it. And then we persist those entries, and then we flush them to the cache, and then to the OSDs, and then we retire the data. And, and for the SSD implementation, we persist both log entries and the data together, and then the rest of the process is similar. So we have for persistence control, we have two modes, persist on write and persist on flush. So on write, we insert a sync point for every write request, a barrier. And for persist on flush, we have a flush request for a sync point for only when a user sends a flush request. So this is a request flow for persist on flush control. So we create an entry in RAM. We ensure that we allocate resources on the device. We ensure that there's enough space on the device. And then the request is queued, and it is completed to the user. We acknowledge to the user, and it's completed once it's in the queue and not on the device. So once we receive a flush request from a user, then the data is flushed to the cache device. Or if we exceed the number of dirty bytes in the cache, we also issue a flush request, and then it's handled by the write log and flusher using the thread pool, and it's flushed to the OSDs eventually, and then we retire the entries. And this is the request for the flow for the persist on write mode. So similarly, we create an entry in RAM. We ensure that there's space on the device. We allocate entries, but we create a sync point for every write request, and we complete to the user once the data is persisted. Over here as well, we flush to the cache once if at all we have exceeded dirty bytes limit in RAM. Then also we issue a flush request to the cache, and then to the OSDs and to the layers below after that. So here's about handling failure scenarios for replicated write log. Because it has a replication on the storage nodes, so I'd like to address how we are planning to handle this, the failure scenarios over here. So initially, one situation is when the primary node, the writing node, has failed. Then we all the previously appended writes will be readable and flushed onto the node, either on reboot or by a replica. And writes which did not finish appending, they won't be readable even though the entries may have been persisted. That's because in replicated write log, we initially flush the data first. So even though we might have data on the cache device, we will still not be able to service those reads from those, because if the device has failed, or rather if the node has failed, we don't have log entries which point to the data. So effectively, the data is lost in such case. if a replica node has failed or a replica cache device, the NVDIMM has failed, then the primary node will proceed without any issues. And meanwhile, in the backend, we have a new replica that's resilvered, and that is replaced. That'll replace the failed replica node. And in a case where the primary node's NVDIMM has failed, the first thing would be if we have a duplicate or an extra NVDIMM on the same node, then we will use that. Like on a reboot, we ensure that the new NVDIMM is taking all the write requests and all the reads are also trying to service from it. In such a case, would not have an extra device. Then it can take advantage of a persist-on-flush mode, because on persist-on-flush, we return to the user only on when a user issues a flush request. So we essentially have all of the data in the RAM when the NVDIMM has failed. So we can redirect them to the replica node, and that can flush them to the OSDs. And if in case that there is no local NVDIMM, then this write is also considered lost. So we took some performance numbers based on the work that we have done so far. So the status of development is we have for replicated write log, we do not have implementation of replication portion yet, but we do have implementation for the cache only as locally implemented, and SSD does not have replication anyway. So we have the implementation so far as to collect the performance data for it. So we ran our implementation on one Ceph client, which had one Intel Optane SSD DCP 4800 and one single storage node, which has SSD P3700 series. So the P4800 on client was acting as a cache device. So we created a 10 GB RBD image size and the cache size of 1 GB, which is default. And we issued 4K FIO plus libRBD random writes. We issued a sync request, that is a flush request for every 32 IOs. And we limited the IOPS for 4,000. We ensured there was ramp time. Essentially, what it means is that you ran FIO or you've given enough requests, basically warming up cache. And then we took our runtime of 10 minutes and we collected the data. So we saw about 94% better tail write latencies for a single RBD image. And we saw 98% better tail latencies when we showed for multiple RBD images plus FIO. And for replicated write log, we used an AP device of 246 gigabytes on the client node. And we had three storage nodes which were using NVMe SSDs for OSD daemons of 1.5 terabyte. And we had 100 gigabyte RBD image size and cache size of 1 GB. We issued FIO plus RBD 4K random writes, and we ran it for 10 minutes. So we saw more or less similar, a little more higher than SSDs, but more or less similar for this as well. That is 95% better tail write latencies. So the comparison is between when you have no cache enabled and then with cache enabled using RWL. And even in the previous case also was when you have no cache versus when you have cache with SSDs enabled. So the upstream status for replicated write log is it's under merging. So the portion which includes the implementation for local cache, so that is underway. And we are working on the design part of replication for it. For SSD caching, we've done an initially small POC to understand where the performance stands. And we are still working on trying to merge it upstream, and our merge target being 2020. That's all I have. Any questions? Okay.